Welcome to the 50th episode of the Interview Series. The Interview Series is a production of One Week Critique, an Iowa-based arts and education nonprofit that offers educational resources and editorial support to students and teachers of the literary arts. You can learn more about us and our programs or support our work by visiting our website, oneweekcritique.com. That's the number one, weekcritique.com. And please like and subscribe to help us continue producing valuable content. I'm Matthew Schmidt, joined today by Raena Shirali. Raena Shirali is the author of two collections of poetry. Her first book, Guilt, by Yes Yes Books, came out in 2017, won the 2018 Milk Kessler Poetry Book Award, and her second, Summonings, to be published by Black Lawrence Press this year in 2022, won the 2021 Hudson Prize. Winner of a Pushcart Prize and a former Philip Roth resident at Bucknell University, Shirali is also the recipient of prizes and honors from Vita, Gulf Coast, Boston Review, and Cosmonauts Avenue. Formerly a co-editor-in-chief of Muzzle Magazine, Shirali now serves as faculty advisor for Folio, a literary magazine dedicated to publishing works by undergraduate students at the national level. She holds an MFA in poetry from The Ohio State University and is an assistant professor of English at Holy Family University. The Indian American poet was raised in Charleston, South Carolina, and now lives in Philadelphia. Welcome, Raena.
Thanks for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Excellent. So today we'll be looking at several drafts, the original of which split into the poems Lucky Inhabitant and Daayan After a Village Feast from Summonings, which comes out in October. And here's a copy here. Would you just start off by talking about the project of Summonings and how you began composing these poems?
Yeah, absolutely. So Summonings, in a one sentence description, investigates the ongoing practice of witch hunting in India. The word witch is sort of loosely translated in the book to the word daayan, which you said is included in one of the titles of these poems. Worth saying up front, that's just one of several words that are used in a variety of dialects to refer to a woman who's been accused of being a witch. So for the sake of cohesion, a word had to be decided on, which is a theme I think you'll see resonate throughout our conversation for the sake of cohesion. And the way I began writing these poems actually came from a few pieces from my first book, from Guilt. So in that book, there were two poems, one called Daayan Summoning Magic and one called Black Magic, which were both the first pieces I wrote in response to this phenomenon. Both of those were direct responses to an Al Jazeera article that came out, I think, in 2013. If I'm not mistaken, which was my first exposure to research around this. There's a great deal of sort of lore in my family around it as well, but this was my first push into the research deep end, I suppose. And yeah, those were the only two poems in that book that engaged with the subject. But as I was on tour with that book and thinking about what would come next, I found myself unable to let it go. And so it very quickly became an intense research obsession, which resulted in the roughly 15 books and articles that are included in Summonings itself, the names of which can be found in the back matter of the text. And the research itself, I think, is worth briefly mentioning because it ranges from books like Susan Sontag's Regarding the Pain of Others, which is, you know, obviously a more philosophical sort of theoretical approach to what happens when we as artists behold the suffering of others, you know, from texts that are that abstract all the way down to, you know, a very specific and entire book dedicated to iterations of violence in regions like Jharkhand and West Bengal and, you know, interviews with women who've survived being attacked for being witches. So broad range of research included here. And because of the range of research, the project began as a persona project. So initially I began composing the poems while looking at one or two books that were very specific, right, to the the sort of politics of accusation and the sort of cultural considerations in these communities in India. But then over time, and as I think as is evinced in these drafts, the concerns of the book grew. And so I think I reached a point where it became clear to me that the book could not be entirely in persona writing. And then there, an Ars Poetica-esque strain emerged from that line of thinking. And so a great deal of the way that research is woven into the book has to do with taking that step back, right? And kind of asking about what is the nature and the ethical implication of writing poems in persona.
And just to give a little more context, mm-hmm. how is it decided that a woman is a witch? And what are the types of things that happen for that decision to be made?
Yeah, it's, you know, there are ways in which that process is very similar to like the Salem witch trials. There, it's honestly kind of, I was shocked in the process to discover how many resonances there are. But I'm already skipping ahead. So let's go back to the original, the easiest part of the question. Not easiest, it's the most complicated for sure, but I can answer it quickly. In these particular societies, some are sort of nomadic, Adivasi is the word for them. So they're sort of nomadic tribes. And some are formerly nomadic tribes that have been kind of forced by British imperialism to be employees on tea plantations. And so there are, you know, a variety of sort of shifting, socioeconomic and political and gender factors and labor tensions and stuff that are really complicated and that the research and the text goes into a bit. But sort of inside of this environment and as a shift from the previously nomadic nature and the previously matriarchal nature of these cultures, as a shift into labor on plantations and through exposure to the British, these societies shifted towards more patriarchal values and to a lack of sort of a lack of women's knowledge being retained, right? And so through that shift, women's knowledge of things like where to find a particular seed, right, began to be regarded with suspicion. So there's this tie between women and land, women and resources. And then I'm going to skip like 10 steps ahead and say the process itself usually has to do with the death of a man near a given woman. So land is more valuable than currency in this world. And so let's say a woman's husband dies, the land that they live on would naturally go to her, right? And so then that kicks off a system by which a given person might say, hey, I saw her trying to eat my child, or, you know, floating in a river where it didn't make sense to float, or floating even though she should have been sinking, right? And so those kind of tropes will seem familiar there. And so the reason that women are victimized in this way usually has to do with the desire to acquire her land, above all. That was a very long-winded answer, but I believe that covers the basics. And, you know, beyond that, there are moments in the book where readers will recognize things like filling pockets with stones, right? Filling women's pockets with stones and putting her in a body of water. And if she floats, she's a witch and she's killed, right? So a lot of these kind of primitive like catch 22 rituals and procedures. There's also a witch doctor who's called an Oja, who claims to have access to like signs that a witch is about. And it's stuff that can't be controlled within these societies, right? Things like crops dying en masse, right? Any sort of economic turmoil can be blamed on a witch, right? So the woman sort of becomes the scapegoat for societal ill in a way that, again, probably brings up resonances of the Salem trials for readers who are familiar with that. Yeah.
Definitely. Yes, very scary stuff.
Sorry, so much.
No, it's good to have this foundation because you know, even some of the things you said weren't completely known to me, right? Like, so it's helpful even for me to hear those things, and it gives me more to come at the material with. You know?
Yeah, glad to hear that. Yeah.
So let's get some of your words in the air here, and we will take a look at the poem that started these two poems. And it's called The Villagers Say Our Plants. And I'll bring it up on the screen for our viewers here. And ask you to read it whenever you're ready.
All right. The villagers say our plants, forgetting the reason for this dirge of rain, trance full of girlhood songs. The Jaher era blooms. Still, the villagers say, ripe for magic. Keep the women indoors while blood lets and lets. Blood in the soil, so they call it filth. Blood on our legs, so they call us gone. They know a lost cause as it melts. No, there's no diluting here. Here where the rice beer starts and stays warm. They say too much skin, and who can blame them? Even as the rain falls, we create our own heat.
Excellent, thank you. So this first draft is compact, and the two poems that come later are much longer poems.
Yeah.
So what did you think this original early draft wasn't doing that the later drafts are, and how did you write into them, taking lines from this poem?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think this draft is a lovely like scintillation or like capsule of the sort of process of writing the book more broadly too, you know, because yeah, you're right, this original poem is so tiny, so compact. And I think my tendency for a long time was to attempt at a compact poem that is holding, you know, the poets love to do this, holding the world within it, right? Holding the entirety of this landscape within it, which should be clear even by hearing me speak for this long is like virtually impossible, right? For one poem to do. And so it just became clear to me that it was trying to hold too much of the research in too small of a space. And then I was thinking about how to expand it. And one line stood out to me, really. And it was the blood in the soil, so they call it filth. Blood on our legs, so they call us gone. And I obsessed over that for a while. I have a habit of putting a line on a sticky note and putting it somewhere over here on this wall to my right that's not visible, that's normally covered in notes. Thankfully, I'm between projects, so there are no notes right now. It's a clean space. But it stayed up there for a while. And I think I noticed a couple things about the line. One was the pacing picks up in the poem with that line, obviously because of the repetition, right? Blood in the soil, blood on our legs. But it also has a very, it's metrically hypnotic. And I could not stop thinking about it. And I wondered, you know, then looking back at the poem, does this fit, right? Does this fit with the thematic concern of the villagers say our plants, as it was once called? And it seemed no, right? This is, it picks up pacing as a moment because it taps into an innate anger and emotion that I have, right? As an artist, which is like comment on this intense misogyny, right? So that was the first line to get taken out, right? Maybe even the only, maybe some tiny moments in future poems that came from this, but that line got taken out, put in its own Word document. And then I'll track that for a second and come back to the other one. And I think once I recognized, oh, there's a pacing increase here, I knew it needed to go into the second half of the whatever it ended up being. And whenever I know a line has speed, that's usually me coming to the end of the poem. I like to end kind of by like falling off a cliff in a piece, like in terms of pacing. So then I did something I had not done before, which was I looked back at my notes, my research notes, which were, they still are, huge documents. And then I ended up separating out by theme. And So I looked back at like specifically notes about menstruation and suspicion of menstruation as aligned with then accusing a woman of being a witch. So there's a thing where if a woman is menstruating and enters a temple, then it's thought that she's a witch, right? So it clearly came out of that, right? That contemplation. And so I took pieces of research from that notes document, right, and put them almost haphazardly in brackets at the top, just to start like, okay, this is the research, and here's me writing the poem underneath it. And that I found that to be incredibly helpful to generating a poem that was not holding the world inside of it, but instead was looking at a particular theme, right, from that world and staying as fixated on it as possible, right, for the duration of the piece. And then later in the process, it occurred to me, okay, the research could be part of the poem too, right, which we can talk about later. And yeah, once I removed the blood from our plants as a piece, then looking back, I thought, okay, this poem needs to be more of a snapshot of like a moment in a much larger story, which is the kind of daily life that these very real people live, right? They have relationships with each other. They make, you know, this haria, this rice beard, like together in groups. There are different sort of communal dynamics in the forest where they go to forage for food, right? So then I went back to that series of notes, right? And again, sort of trained my mind, stayed focused, expanded. And really only once I parsed out the sort of categorical concerns from one another, did each one have space to grow.
So a couple things here. The notes on the wall, do you normally work project-based? And if so, why? Have you broken a lot of other poems and made them, or taken lines and moved them over here to another place? Do you do that a lot as well?
Yeah, I do that a lot. The project-based thing is tripping me up though, because I never operated that way with the first book. Because the first book came out of my MFA program. So each poem was a different like weekly assignment, you know, like that's how they were born. So I didn't have to do as much puzzling, truly. And the first book is not a project book, in the sense that this is very, you know, fixated on one particular world and phenomenon. I think within the project, that is where I started doing the notes, because I was and am still so close to this research that it can be a little tricky to figure out what a lyrical line is responding to in the moment, and to keep it all in a journal can be really hard to look back at as well. Whereas on the note, each individual thing can be sort of like ripped off the wall and put away as it gets metabolized into another poem, right? I did that more with summonings for sure. And I'm a big fan of taking a line from a poem and making it into another poem. There are so many poems in summonings. I would hazard to say 25 of the poems came from taking a line from another poem, putting it in a Word document, finding its research, and building from there. Yeah.
Excellent. So I'm going to bring up Lucky Inhabitant, which is version 3.1. You sent me a lot of versions.
I did,
It was really neat to track how things moved throughout these different forms, especially looking at the format of the poems and how they changed over time.
Yeah.
But I'll ask you while I'm bringing this up, how much anthropological research did you conduct? And how did you decide what research text to include in brackets within the poems?
Yeah. Well, I think in terms of how much anthropological research, it's a tricky question, right? I think it's important for me to reiterate that this is secondary research. I'm not an anthropologist, so I wasn't in the field. Just a lot of reading. And I would say probably 5 years of reading. Of trying to do it every night, you know, as poets do, we try to do something every day, and there's only so much we can do, right, on that front. But the bulk of the research actually, and it's true in both versions that I sent you of this poem, right? The bulk of the research in the book is in the back matter of the text. So associated with any given poem, well, with most of the poems in the book, at the end of the book, there are a series of resources to, for readers to encounter to help them situate the piece within, the broader world of my brain, I guess, the research brain. So some things that exist are a glossary of terms. For example, in another poem we'll look at, right, you can take the word haria and go look, okay, that's rice beer. And here's its significance, right? And another way that the sort of back matter works is there are pieces of research in brackets at the end of the book as a kind of like afterthought epigraph that I chose to put at the end of the book so that the book would not be unreadable, like unreadably academic. And so there is a lot of research, for example, for the poem we're about to look at that you're not seeing while looking at the poem itself. And that process, the decision-making process, it honestly took forever, and it mostly took other people's eyes on the poems. I can't stress enough how helpful it was, especially in a project research-based text, to send a piece to someone without, right, the back matter or whatever research I was considering including or not including, and seeing where there were gaps in connections they were making or where I was being too heavy-handed via inclusion of a given piece of research. So yeah, and I was still in a workshop group, still working the poems with audiences, and performing them was actually really helpful too, to see what resonated when I said out loud before the piece, hey, lucky inhabitant, in response to what instigated a particular witch hunt, all participants interviewed by one anthropologist said Ki Johnny, right? If I didn't say that before, how was the response different, right? So it's just a lot of testing and puzzling and moving things about. We can look at the poem now. Sorry, you had it pulled up and then as happens,
rant
went on,
I mostly wanted people to, see the format of this poem, because you're going to read what ends up in the book.
Yeah, the final version.
And so, first of all, it's much longer, as we've discussed already. Yes. And then when we go and look at 3.2, mm-hmm. we can see that the format is mm-hmm. vastly different from the 3.1.
Yeah.
So why don't you go ahead and read Lucky Inhabitant, and then maybe you can talk a little bit about how you changed the format and why you did so.
Absolutely, I'd love to. Lucky Inhabitant. Failing to conjure even distant relatives, I know not which women precede me, believe all this pain is at least our own. On my lap, experts theorize, witchcraft is no longer a personal matter. State plainly, the women had nails driven into their foreheads, and full up now with steel and scythes and the list of weapons wielded against us, am nauseous and taking it personally, though at least am not asked to detail my assault on television, holding my chin up for photographers, dubbed icon and simultaneously driven out of the nation. Yes, you might say this makes me one of the lucky inhabitants. Yes, here there are no jackfruit trees, but in a chamber, the semicircle of men had red eyes, the kind of eyes that saw no reason and were filled with cruelty. And somewhere online, I am blamed for not remembering. Yes, Gone now my willful ascension, the stairs, his room, and I don't fight back. Know what fate awaits women who protest too much. No matter dialect or country, the question is the same. Ki Johnny, they ask in the motherland, and who knows? Here we throw up our hands and it isn't in prayer. There's blood in the soil, so they call it filth. Blood on our legs, so they call us gone. They're not wrong, and they will not be fooled, won't take it back. It's night, and the jackfruit trees close in. There's chanting in the distance. Who owns this world?
All right, thank you. So.
Go ahead.
I was just thinking, you know, sometimes when you look at a draft of something, or at least me, sometimes when I'm looking at a draft of something, I'm like, well, this is nice, but it's not doing whatever I want it to do. And so I'm like, well, what do I do? I still like the content enough that I want to work on it. And then the question seems to be, well, do I blow it up and like move it around, or do I try to like keep the form here? So like, what were your feelings revising Lucky Inhabitant?
Put the poem in tercets, right, in the three-line stanzas, because of William Carlos Williams, like because of William's idea of the tercet as shifting, changing, unstable, right, uneven entity, and because I like tercets as a form, I think they're a good starting point. For exactly that reason, my work usually deals with instability of some sort, or liminality, or I mean, usually violence. So. Yeah, they can result in a feeling of not being grounded. But reading the draft of Lucky Inhabitant in the tercets, I felt too grounded as I was reading it out loud. And I don't think of myself as a slam poet in any capacity, but I do learn a lot from the slam community and have a lot of friends in the slam community. And I do really love performing a poem. And I think it's really important that the way the poem sounds when performed approximates in some way the experience of visually encountering it on the page. So revising this one formally was making recordings of myself reading it and hearing the breath and hearing where I wanted to manipulate pause via the caesuras, via the breaks, you know, the spaces between phrases. And that also is really indebted to, I was reading Victoria Chang's book, Barbie Chang, incredible book, so good. And she's such a master at handling couplets and single lines alternating, where the caesura dictates the relationship between one phrase and the phrase, you know, that comes just after it. They create these multiplicities of meaning. I'm very bad at that, but I did manage to create a situation where caesura was helping control flow and pace, which is really important for this piece, right? And because like the way the bracketed research works in this poem too, is that it became clear to me in revising the poem that I needed some of the poems in the book to enact for the reader what it was like for me as a reader of that research to encounter such an absolutely altering and horrific detail like the nails, right? Or to encounter the bracketed section of the men had red eyes is account from a woman who's gone sort of like up for trial, you know, in the type of court is a phrase I always forget the name for, not a kangaroo court, something like that. But it's, you know, her in a circle of men who've decided that she's a witch, right? And she's describing seeing their eyes as red, right? So moments like that, I think reading them initially was horrific, right? And so to encounter them, I think needed to exist more in free verse, like outside of a more predictable, not just stanzaic progression, but line break progression even, or a predictable punctuation progression. Like there are still commas in that poem because I don't want a reader to know exactly where they're going to be asked to stop and look. And for the stopping and looking to be, as formally controlled as it is controlled by the inclusion of the research itself.
Gotcha. Yeah. So what about capitalization? How does that factor in to these poems? Because there isn't any capitalization.
Yeah, they weren't always like that. So the online versions of many poems, not including this one, but including some others, are traditionally capitalized. But along with pulling, you know, oh gosh, I'm thinking about like the first versions of the book, which were so dense. At between every poem, there was a page of research. Page of research, poem page of research, like that kind of thing, to sort of meet, try to meet out the research as like an organic whole, you know, front to back experience. And as I was doing that and putting all the research in there, it occurred to me that the I in the poems here, like ethically could not be higher, like should not be capitalized above the actual experiences of the people whose lives I'm looking at, right? And so it felt like a sort of ethics of poetry of witness decision, and it was a very quick decision. It was very like select all and make it all, you know, take it all out of caps, love that button in Microsoft Word. What an amazing button. And then once I pulled all the research, not all, but most of the research into the back matter of the book, I really wanted to make sure that voices of women who have been accused were on the pages themselves. And so the section breaks in the book are marked by plus signs and then quotes from women who have survived being accused of being a witch. And it very quickly sort of clicked into place. Okay, I want to be lowercase and I want these women's words and names and markers to be traditionally capitalized. So yeah, it was really a kind of a question of like, if the book is going to purport to be this kind of project, then the aesthetics have to align with the ethics. Yeah.
Great. So I'm going to bring up Daayan Summons a Bottle. So readers can look at that. We're going to be moving towards Daayan After a Village Feast. And so maybe you could discuss what docupoetics is. And you've talked a lot about the speaker already, but maybe just like expand on what docupoetics is.
Yeah, sure. I'm happy to do that. I'm also realizing, did you ask me about punctuation and I skipped it?
Potentially. No. Well, you talked about punctuation.
Later.
So yeah. I took it off.
It's great. Yeah, docupoetics. Yeah. Well, I think as resources for, you know, anyone who's encountering this interview for that purpose, Poets and Writers has a really awesome page on docupoetics. It links to a lot of other really incredible poets who work in that form. Their definition, just as a like quote, right, is the idea of socially engaged poetry that uses non-literary texts in the poetry itself, right? So here, obviously, the non-literary texts that I'm using are anthropological research. And of course, right, the fact that I'm weaving research both into the poems themselves and into the section breaks, right, where quotes from women are included, necessarily makes this a docupoetics project. But the speaker thing is interesting alongside that, right? Because docupoetics does not necessarily refer to persona poems. What you're looking at on the screen here is a persona poem, right? Daayan does an action, Daayan summons a bottle, is a template that a lot of the titles in the book use to announce, right? That those are the poems in persona, right? And yeah, I think that speaker is a different speaker from the one of Lucky Inhabitant. I would say that Lucky Inhabitant speaker more closely approximates like me as an individual writing. And this poem predated Lucky Inhabitant. It's funny that we actually went in that order, but this revision was much easier, right? Because I'd been writing in the persona mode for quite some time, both in my first book and yeah, in the earlier poems here. So this came out first, and then I was plagued by the bloodlines, and then came the sort of question of, yeah, if I'm in this book as a speaker, where am I, and what is my relationship to the poems that are in, you know, quote unquote persona. Does that answer your question sufficiently? I went on a tangent for sure.
Yeah, no, definitely. I think, you know, one of the things I'm kind of moving towards is talking about the ethics of docupoetics and how one decides that, because it seems like a very impossible thing to do. I mean, you know, like, how do you know, or how do you feel comfortable enough doing the thing that you're doing, whatever that thing may be?
It's a huge question, right? And I think, I mean, it's obviously a question I'm fascinated with. I really cannot recommend Susan Sontag's Regarding the Pain of Others highly enough for anyone who's interested in the question. She has these quotes, I'm not going to get exactly right, but she introduces this idea that she's talking about war photography, really specifically, not poetry. But she introduces the idea that, like, why are we besotted with images of suffering, right? Like, why as humans do we seek that out? Is there something like spiritual or psychic to learn from it that is not simply ogling at the suffering of others, right? That is not suffering as entertainment. And she introduces this idea that, like, we have this idea that we can look at the suffering of others if we also consider our privilege always as on the spectrum of their suffering, like as related to it. And that was really formative for me in thinking about my own personal docupoetics. I also think it's really important to say there are so many different ethics of docupoetics out there, and this is just one, right? So what makes this a docupoetics collection for me is that it demonstrates kind of like a breakdown I had while writing this book, which was, sorry, but should persona poems exist at all, right? And coming to continue writing them to see why should they exist, and enacting the thinking around that on the page within a poem, right? My personal ethic around it is, like, I think no persona poem is successful. Like, I hold as, like, principle that I have failed here. Like, every persona poem is a failure because there's no one can actually embody another person. Of course, that gets really complicated when you bring in, like, fiction, because I don't know what are they doing, you know? Tell me what's going on, fiction writers. I think poetics has like a different set of standards around it. It is a philosophical, like, query, right? That could, I think, distract and, like, be its own book. Easy peasy. People write books about it all the time.
I bring it up because I just find it interesting from a human perspective, right? Because
totally,
you know, if you're alive, you've been given the opportunity to do something. And one of the things you inherently do is think about, you know, what you're doing on the earth and, like, what are you going to do with your time here and who are you and all these major questions. And so, like, I don't necessarily think there's a right or wrong answer to that. It's more of the kind of researching or seeking out or whatever, finding out who it is you are and what you're doing and why you're doing it. But also, like, what makes you happy and how those things kind of coalesce into a life, I guess.
Yeah. And how you're in, I mean, the idea that, like, you can't be interested in something unless you have directly experienced it, like, would necessarily block off each individual into a little cube that never, right? We would never interact with each other. We'd never grow as a species, right? So there's, I think, like, great individual stakes, as you're bringing up, and great communal stakes too, to like always turning over this question, right? I think it's absolutely fascinating because it defines who we are as people, right? The question, I think, is bigger than just persona poetry, which is just itself a huge question, right?
Indeed. All right, so let's look at Daayan after a village feast.
Sure.
And I'll bring it up here for our readers and ask you to read it when you are ready.
Daayan after a village feast. Any way to the bottom of a bottle is one the men will pioneer. Moonlit paths through the pale green growth. They trade tea leaves, tobacco, ghee. They trade what we women toiled. Naturally, we sneak sips, dilute the remainder like kids, slinking on packed mud, careful not to step too heavy. I'm the only one who takes full flasks like this. That's not why they want my pasture. They don't know their own skin glows amber. We all sweat it out the same. Teeth slump against bones, against gums, bones whittled down. Maybe they feel bright yellow in their lungs, the unsung chakra, and think it's my fault their feet slur the dirt. They pull me in with spindly arms, kiss me flat on the forehead, Haria breathing their half lie. How capable they are of love. Moments before the blackout, all their limbs ablaze, the whole world must seem possible and warm and fused. It must be intoxicating to survive. They pass out unarmed, sloughed against fences, so we slip bottles from loose fists, tuck them into our baskets. We become mist, shift groveward, flee.
Excellent, thank you. You did an excellent job reading all of those poems.
Well, thank you, so kind.
So here's another big question for you. I guess all I have is big questions. religion, culture, identity, power, politics, and more feature in this book. And as you've talked about already some, these topics can be complicated by country, wealth, environs, belief. In what ways were you able to focus your lens without being waylaid by, in the enormity of thought and tangents, this project could likely have gone down?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a fun time to be in this brain, I'll tell you that. It's an excellent question with like a very simple set of answers that I'm just gonna rattle off like bullet points. Methodical, obsessive organization. Color labeling your Microsoft Word documents, you can do that. Notes with MLA format citations from jump, like for page numbers for any given quote to be able to, just to be able to go back, you know. Color coding, as I've already said. An Excel doc, keeping track of each theme each poem was addressing. even if they just mentioned it, right? They ended up in that particular sheet of the Excel. A living description of the book, as though from jump I was saying, okay, I'm gonna have to describe this, right? We write our own descriptions for books as poets, the least moneyed artistic field, right? And I edited it every single time the book grew or evolved in some matter. And above all, I think a kind of a willingness to fail, like a mantra that like the project of the book, because of my stance on like the ethics of persona, like kind of has to fail in order to execute. And that like the failing must still do the best I physically can with the research in front of me. Like it has to be a spectacular failure, you know, like a very well-organized failure. And yeah, that is how there were tropes and tangents that were cut, you know, that couldn't make it in, which is always painful. And sometimes you can justify those existing in another project somewhere down the line. Here, I don't think they will.
Well, I mean, you've mentioned failure multiple times, which is curious to me insofar as, you know, the amount of work you put into the book.
Sure.
And do you think the failure that you're talking about is mostly due to the persona, to this project specifically, because I guess I don't see it as a failure, which is why I'm curious, like why that is coming up for you.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think of failure as the idea that like, well, I think of it as talking to the idea that a poem can be enough, or like a poem can be sufficient to the enormity of this reality, right? And that I think is why the word failure for me does not have negative connotation in this particular context. And why I think I embracing the nature of the fact that this kind of failure I'm talking about is a different sort, like a different timbre of failure, because it is completely impossible for me to actually know what this is like, right? And I should say, I don't want to know what it is like to be accused of being a witch and subsequently tortured. And writing the poems was not me trying to imagine that only, right? It was me holding up this particular set of injustices against all the other injustices against women I see around me and in my life all the time, and asking, is there something each of these things can sort of teach us about the other, right? And if I accept that to do that can never actually account for the enormity of this experience, right? That is not mine, then I think it actually liberates me to locate a new kind of truth, right? From the writing of the poem itself. Does that make sense?
Yes, yeah. It does. No, I really like that explanation. It makes a lot of sense. It makes a lot of sense.
I'm glad, because sometimes in my brain it does not seem like it does, you know. Good when it makes sense to people.
Yeah. So to go back to the research, how does one sift through the amount of material that's out there, such as newspaper, anything broadcast whatsoever, the internet, books, scholarship, to find truth? And, you know, I know that's kind of a loaded word in the first place, but how do you do that, and what does witness allow you?
Yeah, I think it's a twofold question, right? Because on the one hand, there's the idea, like the first thing that comes up for me is a question back to you, which is so unfair and typical pedagogical tool, right? What is truth in poetry versus truth in research, right? So I think the first sort of half of the question wonders about how to find like the core set of facts, right, from the enormity of research that is out there. That question is actually interesting for this project because there's just not that much research out there, and a lot of it is rehashing other research, right? So I would find several articles online in Indian newspapers, right, like coming out in the Hindustani or something like that, that were using the anthropological texts that I was using as sources, right? So I think a great deal of it for me was deciding which were my go-tos, like my big guys, and then having the money to get them, right, to buy them, and realizing I'm gonna have to buy this book and like, you know, marginalia it nearly to death in order to do what I need to do here, right? So that I think is like the easy half of the question. The hard half, I think, is like, what is truth in poetry? And I do think that poetry of witness and persona poetry, you know, why not bring it in there, toss it in, allow us to access an emotional truth or a spiritual truth about or around a subject, especially if that subject is something we're unlikely to ever have a personal experience with, right? Like real experience with, that otherwise we may not be able to understand, right? Like the poem should not, I don't know, it goes back to the idea of like the poem is a question, right? Like if it can raise a question in us, a spiritual or psychological question or philosophical that we wouldn't get just from living, then I think that is truth, right? And so like sifting through, I think the research also raises the question for an author who is researching, right? Of like, what for me is the, what big questions is this bringing up, right? And like, what emotional truth am I writing around when I'm engaging with this subject? And as we've sort of like said already here, what that is for me is so different than what it could be for another author with the exact same set of research in front of them, right? And I think that's awesome, so fascinating that so many different emotional truths can resonate out from the same body of research, right? Goes back to even like the base idea of a poetry prompt. Like your teacher, a teacher gives a poetry prompt to a room full of students and even gives a set of words everyone has to use and everyone comes up with something different, right? This, I think the same thing is really true of research. So as much responsibility I felt to making sure I really knew what I was writing about here and knew it well enough to actually lose sense of what I read where, right? As much as I felt that, I do think again, like going back to this idea of being liberated by the idea of truth in poetry being different from the truth of existing, right? Is equally important. Like witness allows us to each meditate differently. And like, I think these poems are a prayer for a different way of existing for women around the world. And like witness here allowed the truth of the book to be like a prayer in that direction.
Yeah, no, that's a great way to think about that. I always find like truth in poetry, like the idea of truth in poetry is such a strange thing.
I know, isn't it?
Because like, I'll go back to something I wrote like 5 years ago. Yeah. And like, I'm sure I thought it was true then.
Sure.
And now I'm like, well, I don't know about that. Like, I don't necessarily agree with that anymore.
Yeah.
But then how can you say like that wasn't the truth, you know, before? It's very like malleable. Over
it's so malleable. It reminds me of, I heard someone say this and I don't remember who, not long ago, that they were not ashamed of their first book, but like wished it could disappear. Like, so proud of it, so happy that like it, you know, that it exists in space of the career and et cetera, and also wanting it to like disappear off the face of the earth because it holds a set of truths that like no longer, and you're affiliated with it forever, right? Like, and because the nature of emotional truth, I think, is malleable within any given person. And I think that way about my first book right now too. And I'm sure I'll feel that way about this book eventually as well, right? Like, as we grow, our authorship grows, and as we grow, our poems just change, right? What's at stake in them changes. And again, I think there's like great beauty in that. And that's why it's so embarrassing to be a poet, you know?
Indeed it is.
Yeah.
Well, Raena, thank you so much for joining me today. Be sure to check out her book, Summonings, out on Black Lawrence Press in October. Thank you again.
Thank you so much.